Members, it is time and we have a quorum. I call to order the meeting. Mr. James To is absent today. Mr. Kenneth Leung and Mr. Christopher Cheung has also indicated that they won't be able to attend. Can I now invite the Bank of Communications and the administration representatives into the meeting, please? We went up to page 37 yesterday. And once they are here, then we could continue. Okay, let's continue with clause-by-clause scrutiny. Yesterday, we went up to page 37. Any questions, please, members? Page 37. If there are no questions, then page 39. Page 43. Members, if you have any questions, please raise them anytime. Page 45, right? 45. Page 47. I have a question on 49. I wonder if Clifford Chan could help me here. 7B. 7-1B. The reserve. Is it the same as the previous reserve or not? Mr. Chairman, I will invite our financial advisor to answer the question. No, there's no difference. It's still the same reserve in accounting terms. It's the same definition. Fine. And so for 7.2, that reserve it has the same meaning, right? Yes. Thank you. Page 51. Legal Advisor. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I would like to ask the administration a question. The taxation arrangement, could the has the administration confirmed that it has no effect on tax revenue? FSDB. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, Legal Advisor, for the question. For Clause 8, once it becomes the law, then on taxation arrangement, the retail and private banking business of the Bank of Communications Hong Kong will be treated as the same as the Bank of Communications Hong Kong branch. So the effect of this clause is that for the any profits or loss for that particular year, then it will be of the Bank of Communications Hong Kong branch will be considered same as that as the profits loss of Bank of Communications Hong Kong. And we're happy with the arrangement because it has no impact on tax revenue. Thank you. Page 53. Now I have a question for the chief executive. Are there any employees in your company under also instead of MPF scheme? Are there any such employees? Yes, Mr. Chairman, some of our employees, a small number of employees, in fact, are under also what we call the Provident Fund. But since that we have the MPF, there are no new employees under the also scheme or Provident Fund scheme. In other words, we just have remaining employees and the number is dwindling. Now, I asked a question because it seems that in Clause 10, you would deal with the MPF arrangement. Well, yes, maybe you just have a handful of employees under also, but how are they going to be dealt with? Can I invite our legal advisor, Ms. Lee, to answer the question? Thank you, Mr. Chairman. As Mr. Shou pointed out just now, for the Bank of Hong Communications Hong Kong branch, there is a small number of employees under the also scheme. It's a closed scheme, actually. That means there are no new members in the scheme. We have already talk to the scheme trustee on how we're going to deal with these employees. Our proposal or our plan is that for the documentation of the scheme, there will be amendments. For the employer in the document, we'll add item G. So if this merger is to take place, then through this bill, the employer will be changed from the Hong Kong branch to Bank of Communications Hong Kong. And because the employees are still under the scheme, they will continue to enjoy all their benefits and entitlements unchanged. How are you going to change the trust? Under the scheme, there is a set of documentation called the trust deed. The trustee just needs some empowerment by the or confirmation by the Hong Kong branch and the Hong Kong office, and then they could amend the trustee documentation, and then the amendment will come into effect. When would that be done? Well, actually, we're doing the work now. We just need to confirm that the bill will be passed. And then we need to designate a commencement date. Actually, for that amendment, we don't need to appoint a date of commencement. The Hong Kong office is an employer because the Hong Kong office is already in existence. But in theory, it is already an employer, but right now it has no business. So at the moment, there are no employees, that's all. Can I ask the Chief Executive further? For people in the also scheme, are they aware of the arrangement? Do they accept the arrangement? Yes, we have already informed them of the arrangement and they accept it. Okay, page 53, any other questions, please? Legal Advisor, just one more point. For the existing employees with the accrued benefits continue, you won't start anew in the calculation of the accrued benefits, is that the case? Yes, clause 9, 1. The purpose is that for the employment contracts, they will be continued. There will be a single continuing employment. That means the length of service will continue to be recognized. In other words, there won't be any effect. Page 57.
We are now on to page 59 in the clause by clause scrutiny of the bill. Sixty-seven. Chairman. For the Bank of Communications shareholding company Hong Kong transferring its business to the Bank of Communications Hong Kong. So what is going to happen to the Bank of Communications Hong Kong branch? It will conduct other businesses. For the retail and private banking businesses, they will be transferred to the newly set up Bank of Communications Hong Kong. As for the other businesses, it will continue. So the Hong Kong branch will continue to operate. I think we were on to page 67. The final page is the explanatory memorandum. Now, do members have any other questions relating to the clause-by-clause scrutiny of the bill? You have two written responses, the Hong Kong MA and Clifford Chance. Are you able to give us that paper within today? I think you were referring to 012. Could you give us the paper by tomorrow? Perhaps I can, you know, give a verbal report. I think our written, response, it's about to be ready. Why don't you give it to us? I just have one point regarding the text. I understand that both business undertakings are both translated as Yip Mo. I don't know whether this is your drafting habit, and would this cause any confusion? Could the legal advisor please check whether or not this is consistent with previous translations? Because I see the word Yip Mo in Chinese, which is translated, is a translation for both, business and undertaking. It's just a minor point. I don't have any other comments other than this one. Ms. Lee will answer this question. Clifford Chance. Thank you, Mr. Ng. In the draft bill, we've made reference of the Citibank merger bill. We noticed that they had also used the same Chinese translation. They use the same terminology. Comparing that with our bill, whenever the word business is used, it normally is followed by other terms, for example, corporate banking business. So it's preceded by corporate banking, or in Chinese, 公司銀行業務. For private banking business, is presented by 私人銀行, private banking. If the word 業務 appears alone, it is interpreted to mean the undertaking. So that is already the standard term. But I think undertaking literally cannot be translated as Yip Mo. I'm just worried that this might cause some confusion. But if you think that there is no confusion, then I'm fine with that. No, I don't have anything further to add. Chairman, in section 16, business is translated as 业务经营, so it's slightly different. And I don't think there should be any confusion. And furthermore, when we look at this term, we need to look at it in its context. The clerk has prepared the paper for us, and there are two outstanding items. The HAMA has given us some figures that members can see whether there's any questions. And Mr. James Toh also asked yesterday as to when the business will, you know, shift to the subsidiary. You haven't told us as to when you started to do this. Well, we have to check our previous records, and we didn't have enough time yesterday. So I have not been able to collect all the required information. Could you give us the paper after the meeting? I don't think it would affect our scrutiny of the bill today. We understand that, well, that we need to you know, understand the big picture. The other one is about which the other paper has more direct bearing on the Bank of Communication, and the clerk has prepared several points. Oh, there was a preliminary draft last night. So there's 3 points, A, B, C. Consider moving CSA to set.
In the proposed definition, excluded property. 或者你看看这几份,你们会不会有什么回应?你们,昨天,我请李小姐。I'll
ask the legal advisor to answer your question. First of all, we've only received this paper when we came this morning. Regarding other business, we've actually studied this point when we went back, and we've also liaised with the bank regarding the reason why we use this term in the draft. We've actually made reference of the Banking Ordinance, Section 4, Schedule 14 of the Banking Ordinance, which also mentions that other than retail and corporate banking and private banking businesses and institutional banking business, besides those, the banks would also engage in other businesses, and they also use the term other businesses. So having considered this, we have decided to continue to use the current draft. Further responses. Any response to B and C? For subsection B, at the meeting yesterday, we've already explained that the bank may define or specify certain examples which by resolution or certificate to determine whether or not a small amount of assets should be dealt with through another arrangement and should not be included under the bill. In other words, they will not be transferred from the branch to the subsidiary. We've already said yesterday that since the bank is conducting its business on a daily basis, so it's very difficult at this moment to exhaust or cover all possible scenarios or such examples. One of which is that customers or the clients may make a request, although up to now we haven't received any such request from customers, but until the appointed day, we cannot rule out that possibility. So at this moment, we cannot exhaust all the categories, although the bank's plan now is that we want to cover the three categories we mentioned yesterday. But we cannot rule out the possibility of other categories taking place or happening. But this would only involve a minority of cases. in the end, the checklist will be submitted to the Hong Kong MA for vetting. Anything else you'd like to add to C? I'll ask the bank's financial controller to respond to the question. I think ourselves and Mr. Leung already explained to members yesterday that assets being equal to reserves plus equity, and equity includes both reserves in the accounting sense. In actual operation, and also in this bill, we think it is necessary for us to include this in the bill, and operationally we don't think there's any problem, and there's a need to include reserves here. Other than that, we have nothing further to add. How about D? In the bill, Chairman, we've made reference to the insurance company's ordinance, and in the definition under the ordinance, there's references made to retail banking business and private and corporate banking businesses, which also have the conducted business of an insurance agent. Although we understand that the relevant amendment to the insurance ordinance and the amendment to our terminology here, I think the legislative process has already been completed, but as of now, such amendments have not yet come into effect. And that is why in the current draft, the terms that we've used are still legal. So you are following the current insurance company's ordinance. That is, we are using the original terms in the existing insurance company's ordinance. Any views from the FSTB? The Chairman, our understanding is that the relevant amendment to the insurance company's ordinance has not yet come into effect. We believe that on the appointed day when it comes to, because it hasn't come into effect now, we've actually reported to the FA panel that we are still planning to set up the operations of the independent insurance authority. So therefore, we're still using the term insurance agent or the definition of insurance agent under the old ordinance.
For clarity, can the FSTB inform this Bills Committee as to when the insurance company's amendment ordinance will come into effect? We're still making the preparation. We believe it will definitely be within this year. But then the actual arrangement will depend on the preparation for the independent insurance authority, say with recruitment and so on, and because that will take some time. So on the appointed date, when the bank business is to be transferred, then the old definition of insurance agent will still be in effect. As for the appointment commencement date of the insurance company's amendment ordinance 2015, once we have made a decision, we will report to Legislative Council as soon as possible. But for now, we haven't got a date yet. So then we could assume that this bill could be passed within this legislative term. Then Bank of Communications, when do you expect the commencement date to be? Let's assume this bill can be passed without hiccups. Within this year. I think it would take 2 more months to deal with it, right? Mr. Shaw? On the actual appointed date, it depends on when this bill can be passed. If the bill could be passed within this term of the LegCo, then there is a good chance that we could open the subsidiary within this year. But of course, there are still other factors to be considered, like upgrading the computer system or giving notice to customers and so on. That all takes time. So that's why we cannot say for certain when the commencement will be. Can I ask one more question? Because we need to make assumptions here, and we have to consider that. Now, I would, of course, assume that this bill could be passed within this term. And the insurance company's amendment ordinance would not yet come into effect fully. But what if the insurance company's amendment ordinance comes into effect? How would it impact on your bill? Can I invite our legal advisor, Ms. Lee, to answer your question, Mr. Chairman? Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, Mr. Shao. As the colleague of the FSTB mentioned, we believe the appointed date of this bill should be before the full commencement of the Insurance Companies Amendment Ordinance 2015, because the government has not a plan, or rather it hasn't got a concrete date as to when the Insurance Companies Ordinance will commence. Now, if that should be the case, then we will comply with the reference changes, and we don't rule out the possibility of having to amend this the term. As the lawyer of Clifford Chance said, we believe the this appointed date of this bill should be before the commencement of the new definition of insurance agent. So we will keep in liaison with the bank and also the insurance of commission. I think what you mentioned should not happen, Mr. Chairman, but just in case the commencement day of the insurance company's amendment ordinance is earlier than the appointed date of this bill, then we will immediately take up discussion with the bank to see any arrangement could be put in place to avoid confusion. Or perhaps we could propose amendments to make sure that the two ordinances tie in neatly. But I think the chance of that happening actually is really slim. My observation is that it will still take some time to set up the insurance authority. As for the preparation of the subsidiary bank, I understand is in an advanced stage. So with the latest information we have, we believe there is a very small chance that there should be any problems in terms of integration. Any other questions, please? I think please you should put that down in writing because it may have an impact. Clifford Chance, just now you assisted the Bills Committee, so can you put that in writing? You mean on all ABC or just D? All ABCD. Yes, give us the written reply, please. It will help our secretariat to write the report. On policy, please also give us something in writing later. Okay, let's deal with some house matters. Now, we have completed scrutiny of the bill. On the first day, Mr. Leung-sing has indicated he would like to request the resumption of second reading debate on the 13th of July. Yes, let me add, because now we have completed the scrutiny of the bill, so I can ensure it's done. So I will then write to the President to ask for ask for leave, because going by the current procedure, I couldn't resume second reading on the 13th of July, so I have to ask for permission from the President. If he gives permission, then we'll have to see, of course, on the 13th of July whether organ bills could be passed, and only after that can we come to the members' bill. So I just want to say that, yes, well, I will try to schedule the resumption on the 13th of July. That will be the last item. But of course, today, I don't know the bill today. I wonder if it will still go on till the 13th of July. That's the medical registration. The other is the private columbaria bill. And there's also the fire services bill. So there are three bills. The fire services is not so tough. But anyway, we have 58 hours left for the council meeting. So I'll see if we can have time for this bill as well. So members' bill is the last item on the list, of course. So and of course, this term of legislature must end on the 15th of July. So we'll try to complete the third reading of this bill on the 13th of July, but whether we can do it, well, we'll just have to see. I must still consult members, of course, whether you agree that Mr. Ng Leung-sing should seek leave from the president to resume the second reading of the bill on the 13th of July. Okay, fine. Thank you. Because the bill will resume its second reading on the 13th of July, there is some procedure to follow before that. And as Mr. Ng Leung-sing explained, we need to seek leave from the president to exempt the notice period or to waive the exempt period for the resumption of second reading of the debate, that's A. And then B, so far it seems that there is no permitted stage amendment, so there is no need to seek leave to waive the notice period. But if members should wish to propose committee state arrangements, they must seek leave from the president. The Bills Committee could consider seeking leave from the president to extend the notice period to noon, the 9th of July 2016. And I will report the work of the Bills Committee at the House Committee meeting on the 8th of July. Any objection? No? So there won't be any members' CSAs? Would any members wish to propose CSAs? No, but still, we can't rule out, you know, we can't stop any members from doing so because it's their right. So as I said, just in case any member wishes to move CSA, we will ask for the notice period to be extended to noon the 9th of July. Okay? Any other questions? No, then we have completed our work and we'll wait for your documents. And then on Friday, I'll give a report at the House Committee meeting. Meeting adjourned.